I'm a Volker Esbergs. I'm a consultant cardiologist, joint position at UCL London and UMC Utrecht, and scientific coordinator of the IMI. You kick off and then I'll take over.
Okie doke. So what we want to start off with today is kind of just, especially for those of you who haven't been involved in the consortium yet, give you a little bit of a background. So it's only going to be like a 5-minute super run through on what we're doing and why we're here today. If you're not yet involved in the consortium per se, or you haven't quite understood what your potential role will be, that's one of the reasons why we're having this meeting, to try to get everybody up to speed and try to get your interest turned on. So we're certainly very open to new people joining. We have lots of work and few hands to do the work. So one of the reasons we wrote up the proposal for this initiative is the recognition, both from academia as well as industry, that today in cardiovascular medicine, we really suffer from many things, of course, but the points we want to address in this project is really poor definition of disease that is not really acknowledging and understanding many of the molecular mechanisms that relate to the disease, and also a lack of total understanding of the comorbidities that actually affect disease prognosis and risk of getting the diseases. One of the other things in particular, when we do trials and when we try to get drugs approved, we suffer from a common understanding of what actually is an appropriate outcome and how we define and measure those outcomes. And in particular in the industry, it's not only the regulators but also the payers. So one of our key objectives in this project is to ideally get the stakeholders at the table, and when we're redefining and expounding upon diseases, that we really want to make sure that we have the stakeholders at the table. So if we're going to have new definitions, ideally we'll move in a direction that we can do the same studies for regulators as well as payers, and when academia does studies there, we're talking about the same thing as in the industry as well. And then, of course, when we do single small studies, one of the biggest issues, especially if we look at and think about big data, is that we're often doing small studies, and a big data approach is not in the hundreds, but in the hundreds of thousands, if not even larger. The result of all these issues is that we, in particular, have a mismatch between the populations that we're studying in RCTs and real-world populations, where a lot of people question the validity of the results of RCTs and how realistic and how valid and precise they might be indeed for people in real-world settings that have not been excluded from the population. So not only in rich populations, but how do the results of RCTs translate into real-world settings. Of course, we have to deal with intra and inter variation and how that affects our results, and certainly to make sure treatment response isn't somehow measured in a way that everyone is understanding and accepting and thinking about the same thing, and how that might be affected by numerous different things. So how are we going to try to address some of these issues? Of course, every project that comes up and writes a proposal and at the beginning is always trying to change the world. I think what we're going to try to do is be very realistic and pragmatic. We have 5 years. We're not richly endowed. We only have a budget of around $10 million, but we have some incredibly impressive people involved in this project. Therefore, we do have some far-reaching aspects and goals of what we would like to achieve. One of the major things is we want to understand disease etiology and prognosis by using unselected populations across Europe. We want to start subphenotyping disease, taking into account co- and multimorbidities and the underlying molecular medicines, mechanisms, and we want to identify easy-to-obtain patient-relevant outcomes. And we hope in the project, so within the next 5 years, to redefine and standardize operational disease and outcome definitions, and thus lead to improved trial design, drug development, and better response to therapy. And to be very concrete, I'm going to hand it over to Volker, but we haven't written on the slides. What we want to do is develop a research platform. So at the end of the 5 years, it won't stop there. We hope to build a research platform where we can include all of the rich data from Europe, that at the end of the 5 years we can continue to do research in this platform. The other thing that we really haven't mentioned is in all of this phenotyping is we want to add omics data to the picture, because in cardiovascular disease that's been missing to date. Well, I shouldn't say that. I'm surrounded by people who've made a career out of genetics and cardiology, but it's still at the beginning, and we hope to add to that process. And I can't think of a better segue than on that topic. Give it to you, Volker.
Thanks, Maureen. So I won't go that much in detail, but I completely echo the words of Maureen that we're building a platform for the long term, and this is, I think, one of the first baby steps that we undertake. I just had a meeting with the American Heart Association as well. We're doing similar initiatives, and we're trying to collaborate already in the early phase. This is just for people who are not aware, the architecture of the IMI grant is different work packages like normal. There's one on outcome definitions, so how can we improve the definitions of relevant heart disease like heart failure? How do we subphenotype those better and reflects the underlying etiology? Work package 3 is harmonization. Of course, we all want to collaborate, but now we're spending PhDs on data curation. Work package 4 is enrichment. How do we get richer data? 5, more advanced analytics, big data analytics for wearable data, using multi-omics layers. And of course, not unimportant, it's not in our radar all the time, but the ethics and the legal perspective, right, the information governance is key in this kind of consortia, but also in this field of data science, in particular considering the new European legislation next year. So Work Package 7 is important, bit far from our bedside, but it's quite crucial. But the red part is the cross-cutting pilot studies or case studies, whatever you want to call it, is just to make sure that work packages collaborate among each other and have a concrete project to work on, because scientists or physicians like to have also short-term goals. And these are the pilot studies where we compare clinical characteristics of randomized clinical trials and real-world patients, see how we can guide future trials, right? How can we improve or extend in exclusion criteria of pharma-led trials. Study 2 is quite important for heart failure. It's a mixed bag of different diagnoses. How can we improve so that we can also get more better resolution for our omic research, but also to identify those patients for certain treatments. 3 is the case study 3 is to see whether we can use registry-based trial data instead of this highly manually educated event committees, what we now use in trials and pharma-led trials predominantly. Already we can just use electronic health record data like what's done in Sweetheart. 4 is the heart failure epidemiology and see what's the differences, right? I think we're a European consortium, so we have to be also serve the European community and see how the care of heart failure patients is different, what maybe the burden is different across the different geographical regions. And it gives us an opportunity to harmonize. So we're working already on this case study, but before we can analyze, we need to harmonize our national registries. And I think that will be one of the main objectives of this whole IMI. 5 is more in the genetic background. So how can we integrate our proteomics, genomics, into drug target validation and prioritization of potential targets. And 6 is how can we use wearable data, which is also part of this as IMI. And in particular, we're going to enrich heart failure trials, but also from Birmingham, we're going to enrich some atrial fibrillation trials with wearables. So instead of looking only at just recurrence of atrial fibrillation, we can really look at the burden of atrial fibrillation, the persistence, instead of only just one single time point. So these are the more concrete case study. We're not limited to those, but just that people get a flavor of what's possible and just have some actionable aims in the short term. So people already, we have formed groups. So the first work package and case study meetings have already occurred. If you want to join up, right, just join. Let Maureen or I know, and I will put you in contact with the relevant people. If you say, okay, that case study, I really like that one, I really want to be part of it, or that work package, just let us know, right? We need all the hands that we can use, and then we connect you to the right people. So today is Maureen, asked me, so what we saw in the preparation of the grant and during the kickoff meeting, there's somehow there's a bit of information gap sometimes between the academia and pharma. So what are the potentials? What are the opportunities within our consortium? Because I think we have a lot of expertise, but I don't think that everybody knows the opportunities that are available. So we just give you, it's a bit of back to basics, right? It's a basic course in different aspects. Right, I'm going to tell about genetic epi and what are the possibilities. Electronic health records, Spiros will talk about it. So what can you do with the type of data? What are the pitfalls as well? It's not all hallelujah. Then we have lunch, and then we go to the medianization, how you can use genetics for prioritization of drug targets, not only for efficacy, but also for adverse event profiles. The same for proteomics, that's more focusing on the redefinition, the subphenotyping based on the proteomics profiles. And then we end up with a workshop by Bram Prince, he's not yet here, but will come this afternoon from Cambridge, using the phenoscanner, so seeing relationships between all kind of phenotypes. So sometimes for people it might be too basic, but that's the purpose, right? So then just ignore that talk and just pay attention to the next one. But for, I think for everyone, it's just to give some sense, right? So there's no high levels, just back to basics, just give some overview what's out there so that you can think about it when you get home. And if you want to do a project with one of us or within our consortium, then you know what we're able to do. So it will be recorded today. So I always like interactive discussion because I never know what people think, but it's probably less appropriate when we recorded this, otherwise it will be right confusing if you look at afterwards. So let's keep the questions to the end, unfortunately, but I think it's better for now. End of each lecture, we'll do Q&A, short Q&A, and some interactive discussion if things are not clear. But it's easier for us to cut later on. So the assignment that I gave myself is to give you some kind of background, some genetics for dummies, to put it respectfully, some back to basics. So what are the opportunities? So normally I start off my lectures with questioning people what they know, but I will not do it. Of course, it will be recorded. So I will skip that one part. But so I will give you the answers myself, right? So because everybody knew how many chromosomes we had and how many billions of nucleotides, so that was an easy one. But you don't want to know how many people know the right answer if you ask it a group of physicians. But we will test another time without recordings. So we are existing on 3 billion bases, around 20,000 genes. We still don't know how many genes we exactly have. We thought we had a lot, right? But we only have 20,000. We're just a bit less than a grape and a bit more than a chicken, but it's close. So we always thought we are smart people, right? We are smarter than other animals, but we do have the same amount of genes. But we found more and more often now that the key is not really in the exons, right? So the protein coding regions of the genome, but it's often in the non-coding part, right? We used to call it junk DNA, but we call it that way because we didn't have a clue what it was, right? We didn't know what's the purpose of it. And now we find, and I will show you later on, that like 80, 90% of every significant genetic variant that we found related to disease is in the junk DNA. So we can see that clearly the key, right, to development of complex diseases, not Mendelian diseases, is more in the regulatory regions. So it's no junk DNA. There's a lot of stuff going on, and in particular in the regulation of the genes itself. And I think that's what makes us different as well as other species, is how you regulate the different genes and interact. So how do we compare each other, right? So how do we differ across in this room? 99.9% we're similar from genetic profile. That's always a bit of a surprise for me for everyone, right? 99.9. So only 0.1% is different between two individuals here in this room. If you compare to zebrafish, we are 70% of the genome is comparable between a zebrafish and a human, and between humans is where. Right, we're all unique, of course, but not that quite, right? 99.9, we're quite similar. So, and the 0.1%, that's something we're all interested in here in this room, because 0.1% gives you a clear insight in mechanisms, in differences, and who's susceptible for disease, who has blue eyes, but also who responds to which drug when. So that's the reason why this whole evolution of human genetics, what gave us a lot of new insights. I will give you a brief overview of what happened in the past few decades. We started off with the linkage analysis to look for Mendelian diseases, so predominantly in families with extreme phenotypes, in cardiovascular dilated cardiomyopathy or sudden death. We did linkage, then we went over to Canada gene studies, where we just had a biological hypothesis, and then we looked in that region, looked for variation and outcome. A lot of flaws, I will tell you. Then moved to genome-wide association studies, more agnostic. So the traditional people always think me or my type of scientist a bit of ignorant or stupid, whatever. It's because we don't think, right? We look genome-wide to see what pops up, right? We don't have any biological questions in comparison to the past. And now we move already a large amount of time already to the sequencing. So what's always the question, what's the difference between GWAS, right, and sequencing? And I will tell you in the next few slides. You always hear the term single nucleotide polymorphisms, just a variation. And always people think it's hard. What is a single nucleotide polymorphism? It's a nucleotide change. And they ask me, what's the difference with a mutation? But there is no difference, right? We use mutation more for Mendelian diseases, that there is like a really a change in protein coding genes, for example, that causes disease, pathogenic, while a SNP is a variation which is more common than a mutation. So I think that's the main difference, is more the frequency, but the concept is just a variation. Nucleotide variation is the same. So I think that's quite important to remember. There's no like a holy thing or something different to a SNP and a mutation. It's just a nucleotide change. So to get back to the Canada gene studies, what we've done in the past, right, is just taking not a random but a biological driven hypothesis. We took a variation and then did a case control and looked for variation, looked for an association. But it was pretty much flawed, right? There were small sample sizes, there was no replication, there was a lot of publication bias, because if you find a positive result, you published it. If you didn't find anything, you didn't publish it, you get to the next genetic variations. So there's a lot of reviews out there which shows clearly that of the old association that found that the majority couldn't be replicated later on. So I think this is polluted the literature quite a lot and also moved us in the wrong way. But I think, and also population stratification, I think is an important point that makes spurious results in this kind of papers. So lack of statistical rigor, lack of replication. I think replication, everybody knows, is now the gold standard. It was just cherry picking, right? You took your hobby gene and looked for variations, didn't correct for multiple testing. It was just an unbiased approach. So I think there's a lot of flaws in that one. And that became different when we turned into GWAS, right? Genome-wide association studies, because then we can look at the whole genome or part of the genome and adjusted for all the multiple testing for the number of variants that we looked into. And we started off in more 2007 in the HapMap project. We had knowledge about 3 million genetic variants from 3 continental populations. Important to know, right? If you study different ethnicities, you have to remember the reference, right? The reference genome is coming from these 3 continents. So you have to be careful if you interpret data from other ethnicities. So 3 million SNPs, right, when we done this in 2007. Only 270 patients were sequenced, the data where it comes from. Now in 2014, we can already genotype more than 80 million variants throughout the genome from 28 populations and across the 5 continents. So I think now it's much, much better. The coverage is much better. So if you're looking at GWAS from the early days, if you redo it, you will get much more signal and much more significant hits, and that's what often happens, right? There's an update, and then people will say, okay, it's imputed according to HapMap, and it's imputed according to the data from HapMap from 3 million SNPs, and then often you see a paper later on, it's imputed by 1,000 genome data, which is far more dense genotypes and imputation quality, because you can now impute to more than 80 million variants. And if you ask me what's the difference then with sequencing, you don't need the reference gene, so you can just sequence every nucleotide in the whole genome, so you don't have to impute using 1,000 genome. So sequencing is quite crucial, especially if you want to look for private mutations, rare mutations, But we're getting better because we already have 80 million, which a lot of those are rare. But if you want a private mutation in a family or in a congenital heart disease, you still have to do sequencing because it will not be covered by this imputation reference panel. Just to show you, there's a lot of, so you can, right, with 23andMe and everything, but you can look at ancestry if you're looking at your genome, where you come from. And that's what we've done, right? So you see a lot of difference in different populations. So remember, if you judge a paper or a scientific study using genetics, it's particularly in the beginning, a lot of errors are made because you have to adjust for the population stratification. Of course, there are a lot of differences. And that, of course, if you can see it in the map in Europe, the differences are also, right, related to lifestyle, right? If you take only, right, if you take the controls from here in comparison to the UK, right, there's a lot of other factors associated, of course, with the different populations that you have to adjust for. Just to show, for Holland itself, which I know it's really, really small, really tiny, but we sequenced in the genome of the Netherlands 250 families with whole genome sequencing, and you can even see, right, there's a lot of differences, right, within, right, a small country like the Netherlands. So that's quite remarkable already. So, and you can see that we don't move that much, right? If we stick to here, then nobody moves afterwards. So the genotyping platform. So we started off with 100,000 only genotypes. So you have to realize if you're doing a GWAS, right? You order Illumina OmniChip, for example, you get direct genotyping, so that these are truly genotyped. But the rest is imputed, right? So I will tell you the concept about imputation. But in the early days, so we had hundreds of thousands of SNPs, 100,000 in a single experiment, or 200,000, even 20,000 we started off. And nowadays we have more than 5 million on a chip. But we can impute it till 80 million. So, and how can we impute? What does it mean? Imputation is just based on the correlation. So SNPs are correlated to each other, right? They're not. Dan will tell you about that. It's of course independent of each other, but it will. There are blocks, haplotype blocks, and they're correlated to each other. And we use this correlation to impute our GWAS data. So what does that mean? So I think that's quite crucial for you to know. So for example, you genotype this SNP here, this red one, but you know it's correlated to those. Then you can impute because there's, right, there are a lot of people having the same structure and the same correlation between the same SNPs, so you can impute the data, so missing data, right? If you have this genotype, you know the others as well. So that's what you do with imputed data. So if you have 80 million variants, that doesn't mean we genotype 80 million variants. That means we genotype 5 million or 2 million SNPs and impute it till 80 million using the 1,000 genome data and using this correlation structure between those SNPs, right, to populate the data. So it's important because you also have to check always the LD, right? So the amount of LD. The LD is linkage disequilibrium, so it's the correlation between the SNPs. If it's 0.8, it's quite good, but if it's 0.2, you have to be careful. Maybe you have to sequence that region again to find a causal variant. Of course, this is what you're doing. So what you see always is in a GWAS study, in a genetics paper, you can see always a gene, right? So we found a new gene or we found a new target. But that's not what we found. What we found is just an RS number, it's a SNP, somewhere in the genome, which is here, and we found a statistical association, which is like in 89% never in a gene, right? It's close by, but we just look in the vicinity. We say, okay, this is just, the gene is just close by, okay, let's call it, it probably relates to the gene, but we don't know. Nowadays, we do functional experiments to check, but in the early days, we say, okay, this is probably the causal gene, which is not the case. Because it can be just a causal variant, can be here, but it can be correlated to each other. So this one pops up as significant, but the causal variant can be a different one. So you have to find map, you have to sequence the region, but nowadays with the more dense genotype arrays, it's easier, becoming easier. And you have to realize often these SNPs are not in a gene, they are just in a non-coding regions. And you have to realize we have to now do it in the vicinity, so close by a gene, and we have some other tricks to annotate it, but you have to realize that sequencing results are nucleotides, you always see it linear, right? You can always see the A's, the C's, T's, right? Next to each other, but that doesn't the case in nature. It's like it's a 3D structure. So sometimes the variant is linked to a DNA on another chromosome or another place in the same chromosome, but like more than 1,000 kb away. So it doesn't have to be in the vicinity. So important to realize. So linkage disequilibrium. Yeah, probably in the future, we don't have to care about this anymore, because then we're going to sequence everyone, like what the UK Biobank is doing and other efforts, so that we don't have to impute anymore. Until then, we need to do this. And then it's quite easy, right? When we just look for comparing allele counts, right? So AB, AB or AB, and look for enrichment in patients versus controls and do a chi-square or a regression analysis. So it's not really fancy. So this is one of the first relevant ones for cardiovascular disease from the Wellcome Trust consortium. It's in GWAS of 14,000 cases, 7 common diseases, and they have 3,000 shared controls. And one of those is coronary heart disease here on the top. And you can clearly see this is, I will explain later on, but you can see the signal, the 9P21 for coronary artery disease, pops up, the most strongest genetic variant in cardiovascular disease, with an alter ratio of 1.2, that's for us, that's is major. And here is the plot more at large. So here's the 9P21. And then here on the x-axis is the chromosome always. So you can see the location. The dots itself are individual SNPs, right? And here's the p-value. So the 10 to the minus 8 is the significance level if you adjust for multiple testing in genome association study. So here is the bar, and everything above it is significant. And you can see here clearly, this is called a Manhattan plot. Of course, it looks like skyscrapers, so that's why it's called Manhattan plot. And you can clearly see why this happens is due to the LD, because there's a lot of SNPs are correlated to each other. So if one SNP is significant, a lot of others are as well. So that's the reason why we call this a Manhattan plot, and you see this kind of structures. Sometimes you see a lone star, but you have to be careful. If you just have a lone star somewhere, it's often a genotyping error or some QC problem or a really true rare variant. So this is the significant value, 5 to 10 to the minus 8, if you correct, for a 1 million test, independent test in a GWAS study. Oh, the Manhattan skyscraper, that's fine. So just a small remark about power, right? Because everybody's always amazed at the amount of samples, but you really need a large amount of samples due to the fact that the odds ratio, right, they're often, so 9P21 is 1.2, which is pretty much pretty high for us. Of course, normally it's 1.05, it's 1.1 for every single nucleotide variant in association. So you need a lot of samples to find a significant result. So it depends, of course, on the frequency. If you have a rare genetic variant with a low effect, you need hundreds of thousands of patients to detect a significant association. And there's the balance. So the statistical or the human genetics people always say to me, yeah, it's just sample size, sample size, sample size. But me as a physician or a scientist physician is saying it's phenotype, phenotype, phenotype. You can also increase your power by making more homogeneous population detect stronger signals. But that's, I think that's what we can discuss later on. That's one of the purposes of HERMES, right? Is to get a better phenotype and so to improve your resolution. So now, 8 years later, the 9P21 is still here, but now we found with more than 15 times more bigger sample size, we found 47 additional loci for coronary heart disease. And we're now pursuing an effort to 1 million heart project. So we're now going to do a genome-wide association study with 1 million patients. And then this list of 47 will substantially increase in the next years. And these are all, a lot of those are already related to traditional cardiovascular disease. They're already drug targets, but still the majority, around 50, 60%, we don't have a clue. And the most important one is 9P21, right? It's the biggest, right? It's related to diabetes. It's related to aortic aneurysms, it's related to coronary heart disease, peripheral artery disease, and we still don't know exactly how it works or how we can target it. So there's a lot of opportunities here. So different approaches, the population-based association studies I just mentioned, the family-based linkage studies, you have a large effect, right? You need only a few families. Here you need big sample size because there are small effects, and then you have, if you have a small frequency, rare variants with small effects, that's the most difficult part. What didn't solve yet, but it will probably be solved when we sequence the UK Biobank and other large consortia, because we need sequencing of thousands and thousands of patients and harmonize our data sets. So the power is a problem. Single variance, it depends on your allele frequency. If you have a low allele frequency, right, you need much more sample size, and the effect size are really low in genetic research. So you have also some, what you can do is the gene burden test. So you can just lump together. That's what they do with the exome chip nowadays. Is they lump together rare genetic variants and create a gene burden. But the results so far have been not as well as running just a GWAS. So just a few slides left. I think so. What I just showed you, 9B21, is the first manifestation of cardiovascular disease, coronary heart disease. We're running within this consortium a few genome-wide association studies, which are a step further. So first, we focused on first manifestation in cardiogram for drug target selection, but then we did the clinical trials like the PCSK9. We're all doing this in secondary prevention cohorts. You, of course, that you want a higher event rate, you need shorter term or follow up. But we have to realize that the evidence comes from the primary population, and there's no knowledge whatsoever of genetic loci on progression of coronary heart disease. And there has been published a few years ago a genome-wide association study on Crohn's disease and progression of Crohn's disease, and the genetic makeup is completely different. So you find other targets if you look at secondary manifestation or progression of disease than just the first manifestation. So that's the reason why we founded together with Riaz Patel from UCL, the Genius CHD Consortium, which is part of the IMI as well. We included patients with established coronary heart disease, of course DNA, and of course follow-up for secondary events. And we have 62 cohorts now included. Around 250,000 patients are part of this consortium. And we're drafting now the first sort of design paper, the first manuscripts on the PCSK9 and IL-6R as potential drug targets, but then looking into secondary manifestations. So that's quite an effort. Then I move lastly, but of course I don't know whether Dan, whether you will point it out, is the heart failure, because it's quite important for our IMI consortium. Is so far it has been quite disappointing, the results from genome association studies on heart failure. This is the Manhattan plot, right? No skyscrapers, a bit of like fuss here. You can see a few lone stars, but they were not replicated in independent cohorts. And that's the reason why Tom Lambers and Dan Swerdlow founded the Hermes Consortium to look for at bigger scale, looking for heart failure, incident heart failure, and survival after heart failure. And I think this is a great initiative. I think the key will be also how we can improve the phenotyping, right? What we plan to do in the IMI as well, and then running GWAS in these improved phenotypes and see whether we find different signals for different forms of heart failure based on underlying mechanism. So we have to redefine the heart failure diagnosis. This is based on taxonomy, and we can use, like, for the proteomics, so hopefully we can hear later on from Tony, so how we can improve the diagnosis of heart failure based on underlying omics or other research. This is an interesting study. I just want to show just more. It's a study what I got from Spiris. It's the phenotype heat map, so unsupervised clustering for heart failure preserved ejection fraction was published in Circulation 2015. For people who don't know how heat maps work, but this is like pretty messy, right? So there's a lot of heterogeneity. So that means if you're putting all kind of clinical characteristics of patients with heart failure with preserved ejection fraction, you see different kind of people, but we treat them the same way, right? And we're doing GWAS on the same. If you're doing GWAS, you know, my association study on this kind of people, right? You don't get signals, right? There's too much noise. So we really have to improve the phenotypic definitions of heart failure predominantly, and then running a GWAS again, and hopefully we find novel targets. But that's something Spears can later address. So what has been done? Family-based linkage studies. We started off 10 years ago for rare Mendelian traits. That's well done. The Kennedy gene association study came afterwards. Many claims. No robust findings, almost terrible track record, and then we moved to genome-wide association studies, the agnostic approach, and I think we found a lot of signals, and the PCSK9 is one of those, as well as success stories, and we're now moving to whole exome sequencing first for the rare Mendelian diseases. We're also moving to the more complex traits and common diseases, but that is problematic in my view, because I think for complex diseases, the answer is not in the coding regions, but it's in the regulatory regions. And that's not covered by the whole exome, but by the whole genome, right? But we're getting there. And I think that we're a lot of answers will get from the whole genome sequencing study if we have enough power. So we have to collaborate not only in Europe, but across the pond as well. So the genomic sequence, GWAS have been very successful over the past 8 years, I think. There's a lot of criticism, right, because it didn't come into clinics yet, but I think people recognize the potential for drug targets. And I think also for prediction, of course, in the beginning, we tried to improve prediction using a single variant with a small effect and say, okay, yeah, but if you use cholesterol, it's much better. But cholesterols, right, there's like hundreds of genes and thousands of genetic variants underlying. So if you take a cholesterol measurement, of course it's better than one single variant with a small effect. But now if you're using more information, there's more genetic variation, you can see that we indeed can improve prediction. A lot of sequencing studies of complex traits are ongoing, but power is still low, as I just addressed, due to the rare variants. But I think that we can solve this if we collaborate among each other. So we need larger sample size, and we need to improve the phenotyping. Phenotyping is really crucial in everything. We cannot solve it just by sequencing more and more and more. And I think, so genetic studies, but hopefully you're convinced already, is to gain information about biology and causality, and will improve at the end of the day our drug target development pipeline to improve life of individual patients. Okay, thanks for your attention for this part then. Sorry, so we just have a few questions, and Spiros, if you can.
I'm trying to understand why phenotyping is so crucial, and it dawned on me that if you knew how specific gene expresses itself in the phenotype, it would be easier to get from the other side, the phenotyping problem.
So that's absolutely true. So I think that we have to move to more an integrated approach between the system biologies and doing the agnostic approach. So what I'm doing now is I'm rerunning genome association study based on whether it's expressed in the right tissue, for example. And we're looking at, so I've done chip sequencing to identify regulatory regions in cardiac tissue, but also vascular tissue. And then we're looking at genetic variation in those areas and see whether it's more relevant. So that's, you can do the phenotyping on clinical characteristics, but also more on the genomics level as well. So we have to find smarter ways. But if you ask me, right, if you want to integrate RNA sequencing and chip sequencing, it's already difficult. And then add genomics or proteomics or metabolomics, how do we we don't know, right? We do always we do genomics and then we do lookups, functional annotation in the different kind of omics, but we never do analyze it together in one go, because we don't have skills yet.
So Folkert, I'm not going to ask you to do a glass ball, but how far away are we to translating this into druggable targets? And if you look at many of the companies around the table, or some who maybe aren't, would you say that there are companies that are better at this than others? And do you believe that that's the future, or do you think we're going to miss the boat if we're not looking at this?
So great question, but Michael, my answer would be it's not the future, it's now, right? So Dan will show later on some examples, right, how you can select drug targets, and we already identified those that are for repurposing of drugs, but also potentially interesting for new compounds or whether small molecules are already available. And if you want me to list a list of names of companies that are more progressive than others, right? You can clearly see, like Regeneron or Amgen with deCODE and Regeneron Genetics, they're much more advanced than others, I think, and clearly see the potential, right, for identifying novel drug targets, but also in other areas beyond cardiovascular disease. In oncology, of course, precision medicine is much more advanced.